Good afternoon. My name is Zebulon Hyben, and I'm the director of chapel music here at Duke University Chapel. It is my pleasure to welcome you virtually to the chapel and to today's organ recital, a celebration of the musical legacy of Marcel Dupré, performed by chapel organist Christopher Jacobson on the Kathleen Upton Burns McClendon Aeolian organ. You can read more about Mr. Jacobson and the music you are about to hear in the PDF program, which should be available wherever you are accessing this live stream. This recital is the fourth event in our 2020-2021 Music from Duke Chapel online concert series. Our next program will be on Sunday, March 21st, when we will present J.S. Bach and His Legacy, a recital of 18th and 19th century German organ works performed by Dr. Robert Parkins, university organist. You can learn more about that recital and other events, including our Sacred on Saturday virtual lecture series, which continues next weekend, on our website, chapel.duke.edu/music. You can support the mission and ministry of Duke Chapel by visiting gifts.duke.edu/chapel. The music department is in debt to the many people who have helped make these virtual programs possible. We would especially like to thank Mr. James Todd, Mr. John Santoyani, Dr. Philip Cave, and all of the members of the chapel staff. We offer an additional word of gratitude to Dr. Matthew Stiegel, director of Duke's Occupational and Environmental Safety Office, who has helped us conduct these programs safely and creatively while remaining in full compliance with all COVID-19 guidelines and protocols. Thank you again for joining us today, and it is now my pleasure to introduce our recitalist, Mr. Christopher Jacobson, FRCO, in a tribute to the musical legacy of Marcel Dupré.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Duke Chapel Online for this live broadcast of this afternoon's recital presented through technology to you in your homes. It is my pleasure to welcome you this afternoon. This concert would not be possible without the help of those that Dr. Hyben mentioned, and as a personal word of thanks, I would like to thank Zeb Hyben, Philip Cave, James Todd, and John Santoyani, who are working behind the scenes today to bring this concert to you. As the music is played, information about the pieces will be displayed on your screen. However, I also encourage you to find the program and program notes with detailed information about the composers and this afternoon's music via the link in the YouTube description box below on your screen. 2020 and 2021 have been extraordinary years. They have marked significant anniversaries in the musical world. Beethoven's 250th, Louis Vierne's 150th, Jean Demessieu's 100th, Igor Stravinsky's 50th, and the 50th anniversary of Marcel Dupré's death in 1971. This year provides an opportunity to share with you some of the music that I have loved since I was a mere high school student, and I am delighted to bring it to you this afternoon. The program also features the music of Dupré's main teachers, Alexandre Guilmant, Charles Marie Widor, and Louis Vierne, all of whom imparted profound musical influence on Dupré in the course of his studies in Paris and early career. The program attempts to show the musical lineage from which Dupré came and that he subsequently passed on to his own students. Arguably the most famous French organist in the 19th century, Alexandre Guilmant, paved the way for the concert organist, having toured several times to America for recitals, playing no fewer than 40 concerts at the largest organ in the world at the St. Louis Fair in 1904. Dupré began formal studies with Guilmant at age 11, and from that time onward, Guilmant relentlessly championed the young virtuoso, doing much to set the stage for his prosperous career. When Dupré began his organ studies in Paris with Guilmant, Widor simultaneously steeped the young prodigy in the rigors of composition and improvisation. Instantly recognizing Dupré's unique talent, Widor took him under his wing, inviting him to be his assistant at the great Cavaille Cole organ at Saint-Sulpice. And over the next three decades, the men remained fast friends, both in and out of the organ loft. Other than his toccata for organ, Widor's Andante Sostenuto from his Symphony Gothique remains one of his most beloved pieces, depicting through music the arresting visuals of soaring Gothic architecture and calm, peaceful interior of these majestic cathedrals throughout France. Dupré's Cortesian Litany exists in four different versions, but it is the organ solo rendition heard today that has become the most popular. Richly harmonized, the melody of the Cortège is one of Dupré's most gorgeous creations. The poignant and prayerful repetitions of the litany begin quietly, building in intensity, leading to a triumphant return of the Cortège theme before a brilliant and brief toccata. Dupré's Cortesian litany followed by Widor's Andante Sostenuto. Dupré was an only child and grew up in a home that easily could be described as a temple of music. His mother was a cellist as well as a pianist, his father a famous organist in his day as well as choral conductor, and his grandfather and aunt, who also lived with the family, were both professional musicians. The Dupré house had a large music room, which was the regular site for chamber music concerts, rehearsals, organ recitals, and just general musical gatherings among the elite of southern France. Most remembered today for his organ works, his prolific output for the organ not only reflects his extensive experience as a teacher, church musician, and a virtuosic performer, but ranges from monumental concert works to plain song-based music to the simplest and most transcendent of musical miniatures. His performing career encompassed nearly 3,000 recitals the world over, and his liturgical improvisations drew crowds of Parisians to the organ loft of Saint-Sulpice nearly every Sunday. During Dupré's last years as a student at the Paris Conservatoire, Widor encouraged him to enter the famous composition competition, the Prix de Rome. It took Dupré several attempts to win, and after his first failed attempt in the summer of 1912, Dupré, disheartened, decided to refresh his spirits at his summer home, writing a new organ work, the Trois Préludes and Fugues, Opus 7. A traditionalist of musical form and structure, Dupré worked tirelessly in his compositions to perfect the structures of Bach, Buxtehude, Handel, and Renaissance masters, while simultaneously eliciting grand virtuosity and freedom in his improvisations. In this way, Dupré's Trois Préludes and Fugues transcend in perfect synthesis their neo-Baroque origins and offer a glimpse into the future of modern organ technique. Today, these works are standard repertoire, but one cannot overestimate their originality in the years just before World War I. While even Widor declared them unplayable upon seeing the score for the first time, Dupré premiered them in Paris, stunning audiences and baffling professionals with leaping octaves, snappy, unexpected syncopations, and massive four-note chords played in the pedals. Dupré's Trois Préludes and Fugues, B major, F minor, and G minor. Louis Vierne, the third great musical mentor to Marcel Dupré, holds a unique place in Dupré's musical and personal past. Vierne first encountered Dupré, the Dupré family, when Marcel was just 10 years old, having just heard him effortlessly and flawlessly perform Bach's Fugue in G minor. Vierne and Dupré, like Widor and Dupré, became the closest of friends, and Vierne frequently vacationed with the Dupré family in Normandy. It was here in 1912, the same year Dupré wrote his Three Preludes and Fugues, that Vierne wrote his third organ symphony and dedicated the work to his friend and student, Dupré. The adagio from the third organ symphony heard this afternoon was a favorite of Dupré's, and he championed it and the finale, playing them hundreds of times on his recital tours to America between 1921 and 1924. Despite his brilliance as a performer and holding the most prestigious organ post in France, organist of the Notre Dame Cathedral, Vierne's life was plagued by hardship and misfortune. In 1916, Vierne traveled to Lausanne, Switzerland to undergo intensive eye surgery in the desperate hopes of restoring his rapidly failing vision. He asked his friend and prize student Dupré to deputize for him at Notre Dame for 5 months while he was away. These 5 months turned into 5 years, as the surgery did not go as planned. And when Vierne returned, much disagreement transpired between him and Dupré as to who was the actual organist of Notre Dame. The rift was so fierce and tumultuous, the two men never spoke again before Vierne's death in 1937. Nevertheless, the adagio from Vierne's third organ symphony held a special place for Dupré and remains a symbol of happier times. During Dupré's first transcontinental concert tour to America, he wrote his Variations on a Noël in 1922. In his memoirs, Dupré recalled writing each variation while traveling by train between American cities ranging from New York to San Diego. Here he discovered the orchestral organs of Ernest Skinner and the Aeolian Organ Company, which boasted electric stop action, enabling the performer to rapidly change tone colors on the organ. The resulting variations embody a kaleidoscope of textures, colors, timbres, and moods. The 10 variations divide into two categories: those where the melody is clearly heard, and those where tone, color, and texture absorb the contours of the theme. These include a rapturous movement for flutes in Variation 2, a mesmerizing flute solo in Variation 5, a circus-like and demonic dance in Variation 7, and a stream of swelling chromatic thirds and sixths in Variation 9. To conclude, a spellbinding fugue and rousing toccata erupt off the last page into a festive peal of bells.